My name is John Mogul. I'm Associate Director at the Wolfsonian. Welcome everyone this afternoon. Thank you very much for joining us. It's really a great privilege and pleasure for us to be able to partner with the Miami Design Preservation League every year. During their big weekend, they let us in on it, and we appreciate it very much. The talks that we feature here during Art Deco Weekend always focus on one aspect or another of the culture of the Art Deco era, but usually we focus in particular, because this is what we do at the Wolfsonian, on material and visual culture, objects and images from buildings and home appliances to advertisements and magazine covers. This afternoon's talk is a little bit of a change of pace for us, because it tackles a different dimension of these decades, the culture of dance, especially social dance, which, as you'll learn, was a part of ordinary lives for most Americans in a way that it simply isn't today. Our speaker today, Walter Nelson, is the go-to authority on this subject. A graduate of the University of California at Berkeley and an Army veteran, Walter has been involved in public history for more than 40 years. He's spoken on subjects that range far beyond dance alone, including the history of costume, historical games, and he's been featured many times on the History Channel, on Showtime, and on A&E. But for the last decade, he's concentrated on researching and recreating early 20th century social dance, using film and other images as his sources, and offering presentations, classes, and leading dance workshops all over California, also in Washington, D.C., and Paris. So Walter, there you are.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. There was a time not so long ago that the whole world danced. It was a time that embraced change, progress, and modernity. It was the era of Art Deco. I'm a student of dance history, and actually, just to skip ahead. My name is Walter Nelson. I'm here all the way from Los Angeles, and I will be talking about dancing in the Age of Deco, the decades between the two world wars, when, based on the available evidence, it appears that a greater proportion of society was social dancing than at any other time in history, before or since. I'm a student of dance history and historical dance instructor, and a longtime organizer of historically themed dance events, of which the most pertinent to this topic is the Avalon Ball, where for 20 years we've been staging a 1930s-style big band dance in the spectacular 1929 Avalon Casino Ballroom in Catalina. My research into the dances of the first half of the 20th century, which I began to support the production of such events, has at its core gathering and examining films from the time. Newsreels, theatrical films, instructional films, and the like, to learn the dances by seeing people actually dancing, rather than trying to just interpret what you find on the printed page. Though I do consult dance books and other written sources as well. In less than an hour, with time for questions, I will try to impart some sense of the place of dance in the society of the time, give a brief sampling of some culture, the dance infrastructure that supported all this dancing, and then finish with a bit about how those folks were actually dancing. I will focus primarily on the U.S. with only brief forays, but beyond our borders. In the past, I've taken many hours and multiple sessions to convey much of this information, so this will necessarily be a very broad overview, short on detail, leaving quite a lot out and aiming to provide a general sense of context for the whole topic of dance in the era. I would suggest checking out my website at walternelson.com and my YouTube channel, which you can eventually find if you search on Walter Nelson, if you want real detail. Since I'll be plowing through, we will have to save the questions to the end. So to begin, back to the Age of Dancing. It's striking when watching old movies, looking at architecture, reading the literature of the time, how pervasive and routine, how taken for granted dancing was. Private parties and informal gatherings, someone starts up the gramophone or pulls out a ukulele and people dance. This can be between the furniture in a living room or on the dirt at a picnic or on the sand at a beach. Dancing is how men and women, boys and girls, connected with one another. Seedy dance halls, grand dance palaces, hotel ballrooms, restaurants and nightclubs, ocean liners and ferry boats, dance pavilions and ballrooms at fairs and amusement parks, and everywhere the dance floors were packed. The dances of the moment were lumped under the term the modern dances. I will go into a bit more detail as to what they were and how they were done later in this presentation. But I will begin by saying they broke with the past in their simplicity, freedom, and intimacy, and seem to have become inextricably linked to the concept of modernity. Like modernity in art, architecture, music, and literature, it sought the essence of a thing, and then from that essence, felt free to challenge past assumptions and constraints and explore new forms of expression. So throughout North America, Europe, and even Asia, South America, and Africa, wherever people were embracing the modern in fashion, architecture, technology, and the like, they were doing the same with modern dances. When Shanghai's Chinese elite joined the modern world in their architecture and institutions, they also built nightclubs and dance halls where they did the modern dances. And here's a photograph of Kemal Atatürk, the president of Turkey and a champion of Western-facing modernism, dancing with his adopted daughter at her wedding. The bride is unveiled and wearing the current Western fashion. He's wearing tails, and they are in the close hold of the foxtrot, something that seems designed to defy the Islamic establishment. In this photograph, through fashion and modern dance, Atatürk is rejecting the past and publicly declaring his allegiance to modernity. Of course, there are always detractors, and the advent of jazz and its attendant modern dancing became, because it was so incredibly popular, also prompted an energetic backlash. First of all, it was a time of open and unblinking racism. No need for code words and dog whistles. People just blurted their hatefulness out aloud in public. Jazz, with its African-American roots, really triggered the bigots, and many threw some anti-Semitism into the mix, pointing to the many popular Jewish composers and musicians of the time as evidence of a vast conspiracy by the Jew and the Negro to use jazz and modern dance to destroy European civilization. That sort of hateful idiocy would be funny if it weren't for the real-world consequences it had in the U.S. and Europe. Moralists were also up in arms and spoke of how jazz-inspired dancing was stirring the blood and exciting the passions and undermining the morals of America's youth, especially young women who were lured into a life of sin and depravity by its seductive rhythms. Some even claimed, without any actual evidence, that it led to mental as well as moral collapse, and asserting that lunatic asylums were filled with people suffering from jazz shock.
If it's naughty to dance the men, sleep each morning after 10, then the answer is yes, I want to be bad.
Fortunately, though, the haters were generally ignored by a population that had survived the horrors and hardships of war and pandemic and just wanted to dance. Dance was central to the way men and women connected socially. Many, perhaps most parties, when presented with the question of, so what do we do once we're all together, answered that by offering dancing. When people got together, they didn't have to rely entirely on conversation to fill the time. They could give their wits a rest for a while and dance. though the dancing was usually simple and intimate enough that conversations could take place on the dance floor as well. The music wasn't so loud that people couldn't hear each other, but it was loud enough that two people talking on the dance floor were not likely to be overheard. They could say anything, the trivial, the profound, the mundane, or romantic. Anything could be said in that most private of public places. Also, the dancing was generally untaxing, so a certain amount of inebriation was no impediment. It blended well with cocktail sipping. This social aspect was enhanced by the expectation that you would dance with multiple partners. It was considered very tiresome and selfish for a couple to only dance with one another. Everyone was expected to participate in this minor deviation from strict monogamy. Etiquette demanded as much dancing promiscuity as could be managed. And a man who could dance presentably would be particularly expected to spread himself around. A greater proportion of the population danced than at any other time, and yet the male capacity to meet the female demand for dance partners still routinely fell short. So it was extremely common for women to dance with other women. It wasn't a gay thing, it was a no big deal thing. Men would generally only dance with men in situations where women were scarce, such as on shipboard, in mining camps, and such. I am, of course, talking about mainstream heterosexual society. At the gay and lesbian gathering places that existed in the shadows or out in the open, depending on the level of tolerance in that area, men dancing with men and women dancing with women was very much a gay thing. But that's a topic for another day. This picture is from Weimar-era Berlin, where they were far more out in the open about that sort of thing than you would tend to find in the U.S. One of the most striking pieces of evidence for the centrality of dance is the taxi dance hall. These were places where men would come, buy tickets at a dime apiece, and trade that in for 2 minutes of anonymous foxtrot with a woman. At the end of her shift, the woman would present all the tickets she had gotten and be paid a nickel apiece. The taxi dance hall in that form is essentially extinct today. In its heyday, the lonely men who were the customers saw it as a natural, normal way to interact with a woman, and the types of dances were simple and intimate enough to meet their craving for human contact. This is an idea that seems totally alien today, but made perfect sense at the time. But first, by way of defining my terms, I should say a few quick words about jazz in this era that F. Scott Fitzgerald christened the Jazz Age. Again, this will be a very brief précis of a very complex topic, breezing over the many variations and nuance in popular music of the time. One of the biggest pitfalls one encounters in the history of oh so many things is looking at a thing that exists today, seeing that there was something by that name in the past, and assuming that it was essentially the same in the past. While the free jazz of today, with its wandering, not very danceable tempos and melody lines, serial improvised solos, and appreciative audiences sitting and politely clapping after each solo, can trace an unbroken line of evolution from the jazz of the 20s to now, the jazz of the Jazz Age was fundamentally different because it was dance music. The demands of dancers meant that the music needed stable structures and regular tempos. The bands of the era made their living as dance bands, so they had to stay within the constraints of dance music. The jazz of the 20s sounds a bit quaint to us now as we look at it through the lens of a century of popular music. But at the time, it was a sensation. Ragtime had set the stage in the first two decades of the 20th century, but as the world came out of the horrors of the Great War and into the progress, frenetic energy and modernity of the 20s, jazz was the soundtrack. And its driving, seductive rhythms demanded that you get up and dance. move on before people start getting up and dancing. Now I'll turn my attention briefly to the massive infrastructure. I won't talk about the thousands of places that just sprung up organically, but I will briefly cherry pick a very few of the purpose-built places with their packed dance floors. I will use a few examples to stand for thousands of similar places. And in this survey, I will be in no way comprehensive. I will probably not mention your favorite splendid example in your own hometown. I will begin with the humble dance hall. These came in all sizes and conditions and very much reflected the community where they were located. In rural areas, nearly every town in America had a dance hall. It was generally a simple structure built from local materials with little more than a floor and a place for a band. Some of these were built by the WPA, since a dance hall was considered to be as much a public work as a post office or a frequent use of WPA halls in the suburban community of Altadena, California. It's called Davies Hall and was built as an essential element of a public park. This run, while it was built in the 30s, looks older, perhaps because the neighborhood around it contains hundreds of examples of craftsman-style bungalows from the early 20th century. It should be noted that many dance halls predated the Deco era, often by many decades. Dancing had been an important social activity well before the 1920s, but it seems to have really exploded in the post-Great War era. By way of illustration, the Titanic did not have a dance floor. The Queen Mary, the Normandy, and all the ocean liners of the 30s had multiples. In cities, dance halls came in all shapes and sizes. Some were extremely humble, perhaps dark, dirty, and dangerous, while many more tried their best to maintain standards and respectability. In the cities, smaller dance halls proliferated, though many were not purpose-built, but were converted spaces in existing structures. Many of these doubled as dance schools, and many dance schools were really just taxi dance halls. The dance hall in this picture, pretty typical of the time, is in a rather unremarkable building. Some key features are visible: a hardwood floor and theater-style seating with pop-up seats around the floor. These seats, while common at the time, have nearly all been removed from any halls that still remain, usually to the purpose of transitioning from dance hall to event space, something that was essential to survive in later non-dancing decades. A step above the humble dance hall was the dance palace. These were contemporary with the movie palaces of the time and shared some important characteristics, especially the idea of bringing a sense of elegance and occasion to the lives of people whose lives might otherwise be humble and a bit drab. I'm most familiar with the dance palaces of my hometown, Los Angeles, and intimately familiar with one of the most spectacular survivors of this genre, the Avalon Casino Ballroom on Catalina Island off the coast of Los Angeles. Not all dance palaces fully embrace the modernist style we now call Art Deco, but this one certainly does. Here are a few images, current and past, of that amazing building. Casino, by the way, refers to the original meaning of a place of public gathering and has nothing to do with gambling, which has never gone on there. Here's a shot of yours truly leading the conga line. It gives a sense of the color and decoration of the place. And though the wide-angle lens tends to exaggerate the size a bit, its dimensions are prodigious. The interior covers 20,000 square feet, and it has the largest circular dance floor in the world with a diameter of over 50 yards. This is the outside of the casino in its current form, almost unchanged from how it was after it was built in 1929. It was commissioned by William Wrigley, the chewing gum king, and owner of the Chicago Cubs, who did their spring training on the island. The casino is built by the folks who did Wrigley Field and shares a lot of features like access ramps rather than stairs, which are safer and more efficient for moving large crowds. It's almost like they built a baseball stadium shell and then filled it with a movie palace on the first floor and a dance palace on the top. And here it is in the late 30s with its usual packed dance floor. Back in the day, as many as 3,000 dancers filled the floor. The available dance floor space was reduced in the years following the war when it was transformed into an event space with tables and such. We now generally cap tickets at a mere 800, though the fire marshal would allow up to 1,200. You can catch a glimpse of the now removed theater seats in this picture. In its first years, they booked only conservative suite bands. By the end of the 30s, they started booking hot bands like Benny Goodman and Bob Crosby, but still forbid swing dancing until after the war. The bands might have been hot, but like the dancers, they were also white. The ballroom was segregated like most dance halls of the time. It integrated in the 1950s. The Avalon Ballroom shares a feature with many other dance facilities. It was integral to a public attraction. Avalon on Catalina was built to be a destination, a sort of island theme park, and you couldn't have a public attraction without providing a dance space. Just over the water on the coast of Los Angeles County, there were several amusement piers. The pier on Santa Monica was home to the La Monica Ballroom, which was also huge. There were several other large dance halls as you worked your way down the beach, and every amusement pier had at least one dance hall, and there was a large public pool with a dance floor upstairs. On the other coast, there's another survivor of this requirement for a dance space and an attraction. This is another place I know well, the Spanish Ballroom at Glen Echo Park in Maryland, a very streamlined, modern site outside Washington, D.C. Here's a typical building in the former amusement park, now a national park and community arts center. And here is the Spanish Ballroom, about a third of the capacity of the Avalon Casino, but still a big hall with nice architecture, a sort of blend of Spanish Revival and Art Deco. It is still in regular use by local dance groups. Another East Coast dance hall of note is the famous Savoy Ballroom in Harlem, which unfortunately closed forever in 1958. I really had to mention it, not for its architecture, but because it likely had a greater impact on the trajectory of American popular music and dance than any other ballroom anywhere. For those not familiar with it, it was a hotbed of creativity and musical innovation, and the birthplace of the Lindy Hop. It was unusual in that it was racially mixed. The white kids could take the A train up to Harlem and learn the latest moves. In one of these images, you can see the famous double stage that allowed two big bands to set up simultaneously, so they could switch off seamlessly without having to reset the stage. The architecture was not monumental like the Avalon, but it was clean, classy, and modern. And the floor was so packed, you probably couldn't see much of it anyway. The 1939 New York World's Fair, where the Savoy had its own pavilion, also had a racially integrated dance space in the open air, where major big bands like Glenn Gray and the Casaloma Orchestra played, because you couldn't have a fair without providing a place to dance. There are so many more American dance palaces I could mention, like the Roseland in New York or the Hollywood Palladium or any number of others, but I've set myself an ambitious agenda, so I will be moving on. In a similar vein to the dance halls and dance palaces, but appealing to a more select audience, was the hotel ballroom. Nearly every hotel built around this time had one or more ballrooms. Hotels are still around, so are there often opulent ballrooms. Unfortunately, in this modern world, nearly all of them have been carpeted over. If you want to dance, they can bring in a segmented dance floor to put over the carpet that hides the real dance floor. Hotels frequently hosted regular dances, evening balls and/or afternoon tea dances with live bands. These dances were for the hotel guests and non-guests who paid the cover. Now I will finish my very incomplete discussion of dance at the pervasive phenomenon of combining dining, or perhaps just drinking, with dancing. This is of particular interest to me, as it is exemplary of how dance was so deeply integrated into the way men and women socialized. Dine-in dance hall restaurants run the social and ethnic spectrum. At the low end, there are dive bars, honky, gramophone, a player piano, later a jukebox, or perhaps one or more musicians who might not be good enough to land a better gig, or on the other hand, perhaps it's cutting-edge musicians taking advantage of the freedom offered by such a place like that to try something new, something everyone might be playing in a few years. Moving up from there, you would have dine and dance restaurants of various types. These could often be simple, middle-class, unpretentious places, but with a small dance floor and a band. Ethnic restaurants like Chinese or Mexican, often called Spanish to avoid anti-Mexican prejudice, were frequently of the dine and dance persuasion. Though according to a Chinese restaurant owner from the era I had a chance to talk to, at least in Los Angeles and San Francisco, the musicians' union saw to it that the owners could only book bands that did not match the ethnicity of the places they played. Sometimes black, but almost always white.
Hang on, sister.
The dine and dance experience was one of the standard dating and socializing options. You could be thrifty and take your girl to the movies, but on special occasions, you could take her out for dinner and dancing, or perhaps the theater and dinner and dancing. At the Chop Suey House, it could be quite affordable. I'll talk about the less affordable options in a moment. Socialize. They'd gather at a table or multiple tables, talk and eat and drink, and take turns dancing with one another. It was very tiresome if you refused to dance or danced only with the one you came with. Mixing it up made it more sociable and increased the sense of connection. And I will conclude with the nightclub. The difference between a nightclub and a straight-up dine-and-dance restaurant wasn't a clear, bright line. But a nightclub frequently had a dance floor. Nightclubs tended to be on the high end as far as expense, and what you'd get for your cover charge and overpriced food and drink was dancing on a crowded floor and intervals of showgirls, comedians, exhibition dancers, and novelty acts, a sort of upscale vaudeville. The term club started as a dodge to evade liquor and cabaret regulations. Hey, we're not a business, we're a private club, with sham membership lists and other window dressing. But by the 30s, they dropped the pretense and club was just a name. Some of these nightclubs had modern architecture, but it seems like most did not. I've noticed that when Hollywood imagined a posh nightclub in the 30s, it was usually a wonder of modern Art Deco design. In the real world, they were often more architecturally pedestrian. I haven't mentioned speakeasies yet, so I will wrap it up with them. Illicit places that served booze could run the gamut from the dark and dangerous dive to the upscale night spot and everywhere in between. There's no particular architectural style associated with them, and with the exception of a few upscale nightclubs, they weren't purpose-built but just did what they could with the space they inhabited. The dancing you might find in such places could be on the wild or dirtier side, as they would tend to attract the thrill-seeking and rebellious. The association of night spots with illegal activities during Prohibition meant that gangsters were deeply involved in owning and running such establishments. With the end of Prohibition, they were still there and were major players in the nightclub scene for many years to come. Now I'll talk a little bit about swing, but first a quick disclaimer. In the following, I'm not telling anyone that you should stop doing what you enjoy. I fully expect most of you will continue to dance as you always have, but hopefully with a better understanding of the historical context. Perhaps others who might not have thought dancing was a thing you could do will see how accessible these dances are and get out of your chairs and onto the dance floor. Now back to the program. So what sort of dancing was happening in these places and the countless more places I've not had a time to mention? This is something almost no one gets right in movies and in historical theme events. Part of this is a result of what I already mentioned with jazz, an idea that the foxtrot or tango that you learned at Arthur Murray last year must be what they were dancing in the 20s. Another is a tendency of people today to focus, when we look back, on the youth culture of the moment, ignoring the broader context. I think a big part of this perception is a result of the current state of our culture, or rather something our current culture has lost. Back in the 20s and 30s, there certainly was a vibrant youth culture, but there was also, pervading every aspect of society, an adult culture. At this time, it was just called society. There was a time when you finished school and went out into the world to earn your living, get married, have children and the like, that you set aside childish things and became an adult. You joined the adult culture. As such, a man or woman of 25 who'd settled down was as much a member as a man or woman of 50. Some aspects of this adult culture were good manners, a certain degree of mature sophistication, and a feeling that you always had to look your best when you went out into the world, to present yourself as well as your means allowed when out in the community. A sense of the special place and desirability of adult culture, of being an adult, seems to have faded away during the anti-establishment 60s, leaving us with sloppy clothes, careless manners, little interest in social dance that was at the core of adult culture, and a lifelong link to the youth cultures of our own particular youth. It also created a tendency when we look back to only see the youth culture of that moment and dismiss the adult culture as so much noise. We only see flappers in the 20s and swing kids in the 30s. In addition to dressing well, dancing was an essential part of membership in the adult culture. Unless prohibited by your religion or physical infirmity, and adult dancing tended to be restrained without a lot of show-off moves. The signature dance of the adult was the foxtrot, but not the foxtrot of today, and certainly not the performative foxtrot of Dancing with the Stars or other modern competition forms. The key things to remember about it are its intimacy and simplicity. The partners were in a relaxed, close hold rather than a frame with dynamic tension. Usually body to body, a degree of intimacy that a lot of moderns find uncomfortable, but which seems to have been largely taken for granted at the time. The close hold and shuffling steps made it an ideal dance for the packed dance floors of the era, though I'm reluctant to say that they danced close because of the frequent crowding, since they also danced close when they weren't crowded. In fact, I suspect its closeness was a big part of the appeal. Cause and effect are difficult to determine, but the end result worked well for all sorts of conditions and surfaces. They would have their hands in any number of possible holds, some of which look quite odd to the modern eye. I suspect many were simply to highlight how little work those hands had to do in the lead. The lead was from the upper body, the core, and could be very unstructured and improvised. The essential step was just walking to the music, though any number of step variations were used, often involving a combination of slow steps, one step on every other beat, and quick steps, one step on every beat. The step was something the leader would set, and the follower would have to pick it up as best she could. Considerate leaders kept it simple or geared his step to his partner's proficiency. A successful dance was not a spectacular performance, since no one was generally watching, but was something that both partners could enjoy. You danced for each other, and at that moment, other people existed only in so much as you didn't want to bump into them.
My position will stand the test. So see, my position is all the best. Merely inhibition can be suppressed. Now I'm normal, quite informal. When I'm seasoned in my prime.
I know some of you out there with some background in dance history will likely think, walking to the music, that's the one step. And indeed it is. But the one step had essentially been assimilated into the foxtrot in the late teens. as had the two-step. Dance masters in their written works insisted that there was a difference between the foxtrot and the one-step, though they didn't agree on what that difference was. But music publishers, band leaders, record producers, and dancers tended to lump almost everything in 4-4 or even 2-4 time, fast or slow, under the name of foxtrot. Nearly every record or sheet music with a danceable 4-4 or 2-4 rhythm was labeled foxtrot, unless it was a tango. This went on for years. My favorite example of this is the first issue of Rock Around the Clock, which is labeled as foxtrot with vocals. Swing records like In the Mood or Sing, Sing, Sing were all labeled foxtrot, as was the Charleston. This quote from the Los Angeles Times in 1914, when the foxtrot was new, sums it up very well. The foxtrot may be a natural, wholesome, carefree romp, or it may become the freakiest bunch of dances ever lured into one cage. That's the beauty of the new dance. There's something in it for everyone. This, I think, sums up why so many moderns miss the point about the Jazz Age foxtrot. Why I keep having people comment on social media, "That's not the foxtrot." Today, foxtrot has boundaries. Today, foxtrot has clear definitions. Today, foxtrot is a dance coequal with the tango, the cha-cha, and the quickstep. It fits into a tiny, tidy box. The foxtrot of the Jazz Age scoffs at your rules, limitations, and definitions. The Jazz Age foxtrot is social dance boiled down to its essence. In its simplest form, it's just two people moving to the music, whether the music is fast, slow, or in between. It is the foundation, the starting place, the default setting. In its simplicity, it provides a blank slate upon which you can build. Any step you can imagine is fair game, and you can move from stepping and moving to the music to Balboa, Shag, Lindy. You can take the steps of the Charleston and blend them with the foxtrot. The foxtrot is infinitely malleable and becomes whatever you want it to be. Which brings me to the dances of youth culture. These would differ from the adult forms in that youth dances tended to be more energetic and emphasize complexity rather than simplicity, since they are often to impress one's peers rather than to simply connect to one's partner. So, starting with the 20s, what is the principal dance of America's youth? Charleston, you say? Well, no, not actually. Once again, it's the foxtrot. Once again, it's snuggling up close to your partner and moving to the music, but the music is different. So now I will address the Charleston. The Charleston is an important dance of the era, but it doesn't really show up until the 20s are almost half over. It first popped up on Broadway in 1923, but it really hit its stride in 1925 and 1926. By 1927, the moves of 1925 are being replaced by things like the black bottom sway and various stomps and hops. In practice, the Charleston as a partner dance was either a set of optional steps you could introduce into your jazzy foxtrot, as we saw in the last clip, or the partners would separate, do their open step Charleston for a while, and then come back together again to do their jazzy foxtrot. I think the most important part of the Charleston story, though, is not in the partner dancing, but in the phenomenon of individuals, mostly women, dancing singly or in groups, often climbing up on tables or other raised surfaces, and doing their wild dance, sometimes lifting their skirts and declaring to the world, "Look at me, I'm wild, free, and sexy." And generally, making a spectacle of themselves and dancing without needing a man. That undignified flapper behavior was a huge break with the decorum that was expected of young ladies in their mother's time, and led many to conclude that the end times were near. Walter's rule of Charleston, by the way, is that when a boy dances the Charleston, it's usually for the benefit of a particular girl. But when a girl dances the Charleston, it's often for the benefit of the whole room. I will also make a quick mention of the two other dances in the modern dance category, the waltz and the tango. I wish I had time to discuss dances in more detail, but we'll have to simply observe that they, like the foxtrot, were very simple and accessible in their jazz age form. The dance evolved a bit as the 20s moved into the 30s. Youth dance, if anything, more energetic and chaotic, while adult dancing moved into in the other direction as the smooth, romantic foxtrot became more fashionable. The early 30s also saw the introduction of the rumba, to be followed later in the 30s by the samba and the conga, which I would love to discuss, but don't have time. So this is also the era of the development of swing. Swing music stormed popular culture in 1935 when Benny Goodman, broadcasting from the Palomar Ballroom in my hometown of Los Angeles, pulled out some arrangements he'd bought from the Harlem musician Fletcher Henderson, told the world it was called swing music, and the rest is history. For the next decade, up-tempo music had to swing. Swing had been around for years before that, referring to a certain feel in African-American jazz. Duke Ellington's "It Don't Mean a Thing If It Ain't Got That Swing" dates from 1932, but the rest of the world was calling it something like jungle music. However, once the swing switch was thrown by Benny, when people danced the dances that were already around, the Lindy Hop for the Harlem set, Shag Among the Collegiate set, and whatever struck a kid's fancy pretty much everywhere, it all became swing dancing. It might also be lumped under the term jitterbug, which was also a collective noun for the kids who were doing the swing dancing. As a side note, jitterbug was Harlem slang for someone with delirium tremens. I can and have gone on for hours about the variety and cheerful chaos of youth dancing in the 30s. It was a mess. One of the traps we can fall into is imagining that the swing of the 1930s, at the moment of its birth, was as structured and well-documented as it is today. That back then, everyone used the same names for things, and that certain moves were always done in a particular way, and that the dance of the time conformed to the orthodoxies of today. Swing as it is danced today, taught by such greats as Frankie Manning, is in each of its particulars, historically correct. However, it is not the only truth in a world where new moves were being invented on every dance floor and most kids were faking it as best they could. What should also be remembered is that swing was not a mainstream adult dance in the 1930s. In fact, unlike the Charleston, which actually had a brief moment when some adults were willing, in the spirit of modernity, to give it a try and then quickly give it up, swing dancing didn't really penetrate much into the over 25 set in the 1930s. Furthermore, it was outright banned in many dance halls. Mainstream America was dancing to the swing music of Glenn Miller and Count Basie, but they were doing energetic foxtrots to it. There's an easy-to-miss detail in It's a Wonderful Life. In the alternate reality hellscape of Potterville, the building alone has become a dance hall. And just so you know how bad it has gotten, the dance hall says, "Welcome Jitterbugs" on it. Another thing to remember is that most kids, even the ones who could swing dance, were also dancing the foxtrot, or even the waltz, when the music called for it. This is probably all I have time for, if there's going to be any time for questions. To recap my main takeaways in this extremely brief talk. Dance was pervasive and almost universal. Almost everyone danced. It was an essential element of the social connection between men and women. When almost everyone dances, they do a dance almost anyone can do. And that was primarily the foxtrot. The foxtrot was simple, very intimate, and unstructured, and could provide a platform to launch any number of dances and variations. This universal dancing drove a massive dance infrastructure unlike anything we can imagine today. And the remnants are all around us. And finally, the modern dances were inextricably linked to the idea of modernity. You didn't dance because they were modern. You danced them because you were modern. Oops. Yes. And now I will conclude. I will conclude with a 3-minute film taken at the 1939 New York World's Fair in their outdoor dance floor. It is a silent home movie, and many people have put music to it on the internet. Nearly all of them just put on a swing tune, ignoring what the dancers are actually doing. In my take on this, I found music by the Casa Loma Orchestra, the band on the stage, that seems to match the dancing at any particular moment. I've yet to find another film that so perfectly encapsulates the essence of youth and adult dancing at the end of the 30s. Yes, it's nearly all females dancing together, but then, as I said, it was no big deal back then.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Walter, for that.